Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you, God, for bringing us together here at Trinity Christian Center, God. We praise your name, and we know, God, that you are here and you're going to move here. Each and every time we come here, we feel your presence, God. God, we pray for the sick. We pray for those that are in need of finances, God. We pray for all the needs out there that I don't even know, God, but you know. We pray, God, that you will heal the sick, God, and that you will help those that need jobs, God, get a job, God, and be able to provide. And we give you the praise and glory, God, and we just thank you for this time of coming together and fellowshipping and being here mostly for you, God. Thank you, Jesus. We give you the praise and the glory, the honor, in Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Would you guys stand with us? We're going to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. You are here, moving in our midst. We worship you.
Hallelujah.
We worship you. You are here, meeting every need. We worship you. We worship you. You are here. You are here, touching every heart. We worship. We worship you. You're healing every heart. You are here, healing every heart. We worship you. We worship you. We worship. We worship you. On praise if you're excited to worship Him this morning. Hallelujah. We lift our hands in the sanctuary. Praise the Lord.
We will praise you for the rest of our days.
set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was good. Hallelujah. I had a dream last night. Is it okay if I testify? I had a dream last night about my granddaughter, Marley. And she was in the car with me, and we was just driving, and She was her loquacious self because she loved to ask questions. And so she was asking Grandma all these questions. And I was trying to answer her as best as I could. And then she told me that she had memorized a poem that I had suggested that she look at Maya Angelou, I Arise. I Arise. I don't know how many people are familiar with that, but you should look it up on YouTube. Because no matter what it's saying, I arise. And I'm so happy that she is getting that. No matter what happens, she will arise. And I was thinking about the last time I spoke up here on the fear of the Lord. And one of the things it said in Psalms 126, when you fear the Lord, you will enjoy your grandchildren. And I was sitting there, and what really spoke to me, y'all have to excuse me for a moment, when I heard a little voice saying, there is no other name like Jesus. I'm glad she's learning that, because that's the only name that will save you, that will help you, that will lift you up, that will be the glory of your head, that will walk with you, that will talk with you, that will let you know that you are accepted in the Beloved. The name Jesus. So, the reason I'm up here this morning, I asked Pastor Sherry, we're in 2020, do we want to continue this? And she told me yes. So my job is to talk about tithes and offerings. But you know, I'm kind of losing the word tithes and picking up the word giving. We're New Testament believers, and we can give way more than 10%. Amen? And God took me to 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6 through 8. And this is Paul talking to Timothy. Timothy is a young leader, so he's giving him advice. And he said, yet true godliness with contentment. Listen to those words. Godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. Godliness with contentment is great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. So if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. Amen? That really speaks to me. Now, contentment is a spiritual weapon. Did you hear what I said? Contentment is a spiritual weapon against greed. Greed is a tool of the enemy to make people covet material things. They really do not need it, nor can they afford it at this time. Luke 12:15 say, beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not manifested by how much you own. Somebody in the house ought to say amen. Amen. Giving makes you more like Jesus. The more you become like Jesus, the better it is for everyone. Amen? Amen. Giving sets you free from earthly voices and helps mold you into the image of your Savior. Amen? Amen. Giving silences. It shuts it up. The voice of selfish flesh and turns up the volume of the voice of the Spirit. Amen. I want to hear my Father talking to me. Amen. Hallelujah. I don't want to hear these earthly voices all the time. I want to hear His voice. And I know His voice. You know why I know His voice? Because I'm His sheep. And the Bible says His sheep know His voice, and the voice of a stranger, they will not obey. Amen? So today we have a great opportunity to come to the house and give. Give. Somebody say give.
Give.
Look at your neighbor and say give.
Give.
Give. Why are we giving? To take care of the house of God. To take care of our pastor. That's why we're giving. So there is an envelope in front of you. And I'm asking you today, to fill that out and give into the kingdom of God. If you can only give 10%, so be it. But if you can give more, give more. Giving is like Jesus. Giving is like our Father, because he said that he so loved the world that he gave. We want to be like him. Amen. Father God, we just come before you this morning. Lord, thank you for this house, Trinity Christian Center, Lord God. Each and every day we come to this place, Lord God, and you meet us there. And this morning we just want to say thank you, Lord God. You said to enter the gates with thanksgiving and to enter the courts with praise. And this morning, God, we do that. And we prepare to give unto your kingdom, Lord God, that it would lack nothing. Nothing. So, Father, I thank you for this opportunity. And, Lord, I check my heart. I locate my heart. And I give to this house in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise him, praise him. Praise him in the morning, praise him in the night. Praise him, praise him. Praise him when the sun comes down. Worship him, worship him. Worship him in the morning, worship him in the night. Somebody a good handshake. Tell them I'm glad you're in the house of God. Amen.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship in one accord is a praise. Every praise.
Every praise is to
off real quick. Hallelujah. Thank you, praise team. Y'all are awesome. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Some people getting some breakthroughs in this house. Amen. You get some breakthroughs, you just want to shout and dance. Amen. Hallelujah. Make sure that you buy a ticket today. Do we have tickets? Could you show me where the tickets are? I just want to make sure that y'all come to this because it's going to be fun. I spoke to my friend, Bishop Darrell Croft, and his wife. They're going to be coming up here. They're very excited. And they used to do marriage seminars, so they're really excited about coming. And I want you to come. It's going to be fun. And bring a friend. Invite someone to come. Amen? They're going to get ministered to, so it'll be really, really good. The food's going to be really off the charts. Donna is going to make prime rib. We're going to have shrimp scampi, nice Caesar salad. What else? Oh, like potatoes rolled in like garlic or something. You know, that salt, garlic, right? Yeah, garlic potatoes. Garlic and herb. Potatoes. Yeah, that's it. Something like that. And we got a chocolate fountain. It's going to be good. You're going to have chocolate. Everybody knows chocolate's good, right? Lady Donna, you got some tickets here. We got tickets here. One for 30, two for 60 for you. Very good deal.
Very, very good.
Very good deal. You wanna come. Don't miss this night. It's gonna be spectacular. You're gonna have a lot of fun. You're gonna have some laughter and you're going to hear a good word. It's going to encourage you in your relationships. Amen. And so I want you to get a ticket today. And then maybe invite a friend to come. It's going to be a lot of fun. Dress up if you can. If you got a tuxedo, wear it. You got a gown? Wear it. I want to see some flash. Amen. If you got it, wear it. If you don't, it's okay. Just come the best you can. Amen. You're going to come in a suit? Good? Okay. I want to see you dressed up. Amen. I want to see your wife all dazzled up. Does she have any nice fancy earrings? Do you need to get her some?
She's got a waffle.
Okay, that's a good thing. A waffle. We got the best youth pastor ever in all the world. Let's just give it up for him. Come on. He's here Sunday morning. He teaches the kids Sunday night if he's not preaching in the pulpit. He's a pretty good preacher. And then Wednesday night and also Friday night they have youth. And they go out. And I don't know what all they do, but they're having some fun. And I just want to say thank you. And Rob's been helping. And I just want to say thank you as well. And it's been good. This is how we build some unity with our young people. And God's good. So I'm going to let you pray over these kids today. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. All right, hey guys, point your hands towards the kids.
Hallelujah.
Let's pray for the adults. Point your hands towards the adults. Amen. I like you, Luke. He's all comfortable. Hallelujah, Father God. I thank you so much for this morning, Lord. I thank you woke us up. And you got us here. You got us on our way, Lord. You put breath in our lungs, Father. And I thank you, Lord, that you're going to put your word in our hearts, Lord God, that we might not sin against you, Father. We thank you for what you're going to do in these children's lives, Lord God. I pray that you protect them and you cover them with your blood, Lord, and you encamp your angels around them, God. And you go before them, Father. Lord, that you cause your face to shine upon them, God. Hallelujah, that they be the first, Lord God, and not last, Lord Jesus. I thank you for what you're doing in their lives, Lord, and that they're lights in their families, Lord God, and that they're ministering to their parents, Father, and that they're ministering to their classmates, Father. Lord God, because you said in the last days, you shall pour out your spirit upon all flesh, Lord God, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Hallelujah, and I thank you, Lord, that what you're going to do in these young people's lives, Lord God, you're going to pour power upon them, that they may be witnesses in this world, Father. And I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm going to speak this morning on a love that frees. A love that frees us. Frees us. Hallelujah. So if you have your Bibles, first turn with me to Acts chapter 17, verse 28. And then we're going to go to 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. I know today is the Super Bowl.
And probably the Kansas City Chiefs will win today. My mom is a Kansas City fan. She was born in Kansas City, and so she wears all the stuff, you know, the earrings. She's wild whenever she jumps up and down. She screams. She says, I don't know if I can watch it. My blood pressure goes up. I haven't been able to really watch it over these years because she's like, it's so stressed out if they lose. My mom is very competitive when it comes to the game. Amen? But our family, when we watch football, it's not quiet in the house. It's like, you know, loud. We get excited about the game, amen? And when Gary played football, you know, I used to love watching him play, and of course I love watching my kids play, but he said, out of all the stands, who could he hear? So I know, you know, I got pretty loud, probably lost my voice at times, but sometimes I didn't agree with what the ref would say. But I know the game, and I love it. I think it's a lot of fun. So, praise God. I think Tom Jones, is that his name? What was his name? The prophet. Jones. Bob Jones. He's passed away. Tom Jones. Is that the guy that the singer? Bob Jones is the prophet. And he prophesied that when Kansas City won a Super Bowl, there would be a great move of God after that. So I'm praying Kansas City wins today so we can have a great move of God. Amen. And that was a prophecy that he gave. How many years ago? 35 years ago. So it's time. Hallelujah. Praise God. Are you ready to get in the Word today? Hallelujah. Acts chapter 17, verse 28, the Bible says, for in him we live and we move and we have our being. Amen? He said, we are his offspring. Isn't that awesome to know that we are his offspring? In him I live and I move and exist. As some of our own poets have said, we are his offspring. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. 1 John, I love the first, second, and third chapter of John. It speaks about love. I love the book of John. John, 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. If you're there, let me hear you say a big amen.
Amen.
Now say with me, the Bible says. We're not saying what Pastor Sherry says, we're saying what the Bible says. Amen? The Bible says, dear friends, let us continue to what? Love one another, for love comes from God. Anyone who loves is a child of God and knows God. For anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us. And he sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us that much, we surely ought to love each other. Amen. No one has ever seen God, but if we love each other, God lives in us and his love is brought to full expression in us. And God has given us his Spirit as proof that we live in him and he in us. Furthermore, we have seen with our own eyes and now testify that the Father sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. The Savior of what? The world. All who declare that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them. And they live in God. In him we live and we move and we exist and we have our being. Amen? We know how much God loves us. And we have put our what? In what? His love. Because God is love and all who live in love live in God. And God lives in them. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face him with what? Confidence, because we live like Jesus here in the world. Here in what? This world. Such love has no fear, because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it is for fear of punishment. And this shows that we have not fully experienced his perfect love. We love each other because he loved us first. If someone says, "I love God," but hates a fellow believer, that person is a liar. For if we don't love people we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? And he has given us this command: those who love God must also love their fellow believers. You gotta love me, and I gotta love you. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word, because it is so precious. Hide it in my heart, oh God, that I might not ever sin against you. Thank you for covering me with your precious blood. Heal me, Lord, and I will be healed. Save me, God, and I will be saved because of your blood. Because I believe, because I have faith in you. I worship your mighty name today, and I thank you for your mercies that are fresh anew every morning. How awesome you are. How wonderful you are. How perfect you are. We love you, Lord. I thank you that I can live in you and you in me. In him I live and I move and I have my being. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The Bible says that love is the greatest gift of all. Love is life-giving. It energizes you. It motivates people to get up every day and keep on going. Love gives life a purpose and a meaning. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Years ago, I went through a terrible battle of depression. I really don't know what the central cause was. Warfare. Maybe it was a few things collected together that are not worthy of reminiscing over. Sometimes it's just not worthy bringing up the stuff. You know what I'm saying? But at that time in my life, God gave me a little boy. Because I had so much love for him, he was the reason I would get up, I would get dressed, I would feed him, I would love on him, and I would be the best mom I could be for that little boy. He truly kept me alive and was the reason why I survived a very difficult time in my life. Because see, you know what? God knows exactly what you need when you need it. He was my gift of love. Sometimes people face moments in their lives that they either feel unloved or they have no one to love. They process negative thinking because they are looking for fulfillment in ways that seem good at first, but often they leave them feeling empty and frustrated, sad, and disappointed on the inside. Has this ever happened to you? Do you ever look for love and end up feeling unfulfilled? Anybody ever been there? Looking for love in all the wrong places. Looking for love, what? Too many faces. <Da-da-da-da>. Oh, I'm looking for love. I wish I had a string I could pull to make you sing. Hi, I'm Teddy. Ain't it a lovely day? Then I know every time I spoke the words were right. No one would know the mess I made of my life. I wish I was a teddy bear. Not living or loving, not going nowhere. Thank you. I wish I was a teddy bear. This is what country music does! Oh! Makes you cry. I got a tear in my beard. you know what? It burns like a couple bags of potato chips. What kind of love are you pursuing? I just want to know. We should be pursuing God's kind of love. It's called agape love. This is the highest form of love. Listen, if you listen today, you might learn something. It's the highest form of love. Lewis identified unconditional love as agape. The word was borrowed from the Greek word for charity, or the love of a parent for a child. See, this is how I relate to the agape love. In the biblical text originally written in the Greek, the word agape is used to imply any kind of selfless love, whether between human beings or between humans and God. Charity and the love of God for man and a man for God. I think about a mother's love. It's an agape love. You'll do anything for that child, right? That child can't give you anything back. Not right at first. That first smile gets you though, doesn't it? But how many hours do you get up in the night and feed them? Baby, you love them. That's that love, because that baby's not giving back to you at that moment, but you're giving, right? In Hebrews chapter 1, you're going to get it a little more. Just stay with me. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. Turn with me. This is the great faith chapter, book in the Bible. I love the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. If you're there, let me hear you say a big amen.
Amen.
The sun radiates God's own glory. Who does?
The sun.
Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. I love that. The sun radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God, and he sustains everything by the mighty power of his command. And when he has cleansed us from our sins, he sat down in the place of honor at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. Christ is our energy, our source of life. This love from God is the greatest and highest form of love. Agape love transcends all others. This love is not a response, and it's not dependent on the other person to do or to be anything. Agape love goes beyond what is considered natural. This is love is called agape love. Now listen to me. He is perfect. Jesus Christ is perfect. He had no sin. He without sin. He knew no sin, but he took on the sin for us. I don't know about you, but how many times if you've had a sick little baby and you're loving on this baby and this baby is not feeling good and you would rather take the sickness, you would rather take the pain than that they would ever have to take. Your heart just melts and you're aching and you don't want your child to have to go through some things. You said, let me take it for them. Well, that's what Jesus did. He said, let me take it for you. I'll take the disease. I'll take the sickness for you. I'll take all the sin. I'll take all the punishment just for you. See, it's like a father's love for us. It's that agape love. I'll take it. I'll take the whipping. I'll take the sins. I'll take your guilt. I'll take all your shame so you don't have to take it, because I love you.
Amen.
That's that agape love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 7. Say with me, the Bible says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not irritable. And it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Amen. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Can I hear a big amen? Amen. We need to put that on our refrigerators. Maybe you need to practice once a week. Love is patient and kind. Just put that up there. Am I patient and kind today? Maybe love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. Have I been rude today? I'm not irritable. Have I been irritable? Have you been irritable? That's what love is. The Bible says in Romans 8:28, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. I was talking to someone this week on the phone, and I know that there's a change in their life, complete change, because there was a time in their life where everything they said was negative about everything and everyone. But there was a change in their life because they wouldn't say one negative word about anything or anyone. And I've noticed that. That means there was a true change in their heart and in their life. That's good. And consciously making the decision, I'm not going to say anything bad about anyone. Isn't that powerful? A lot of times we have this, we try to get the splinter out of someone's eye. We come over here and say, you have got a big problem, and I'm going to try to get this out, when we have a big 2x4 coming out of our own. Yeah. You know, we need to be nice. Number two, I've got a short sermon today, but it's good, right? Short and sweet. Number two, God is love. Lynn, I crack him up all the time. He's always laughing at me. God is love. Look at your neighbor and say, God is love. You may be looking for love in all the wrong places, but you need to be looking for God. You may be looking for love, but really you're looking for God. Because he is love. Any love you gain that is disconnected from God is really not love and will leave you feeling unfulfilled. I believe it's important to find someone that will be equally yoked with you. Don't go chasing. Dear Lord, why are all these songs coming to my head? February. Try to please me. Don't change the color of your hair. What in the world? Lord, help me. I love you just the way you are. Is that what it is? Oh. God must be the center of your life, and he will keep you balanced and keep you from tipping over. He's the center. He's the reason. He can make your love so awesome. Listen to me. So you got a triangle. Anybody got a triangle? Can you help me? Come here a second. Make me a triangle with your fingers. Like that. Yeah, come up here. Show everybody. Do a triangle. Okay, so here, this is God, right here. And this is you, and this is your significant other, right here. Your spouse, girlfriend, boyfriend, whatever. The closer you get to God, and the closer they get to God, the closer you get to one another. Your love life becomes very spiritual. But if God is here and you only have one getting close to God, and the other one down here, then it makes you feel unbalanced, right? So if God is the center, thank you, your relationship will be so much better. Let's give him a hand. He did it. The Bible says that in him we live and we move and we have our being. That tells me that without him, life is not complete. I don't know what I would do without Jesus. He's been my best friend all my life. Amen? Everyone is looking for love. Are you looking for God's love? It's the only love that matters, the only love that lasts, and it's the only love that will fulfill. Amen? There's no fear in God's love. God is not the author of fear. The enemy is. You need to get that in your mind. There is power in the name of Jesus. This week I went and prayed at a house. They were having all kinds of spooks running around. Whatever. All right, so just let me come in there. We laid hands. We went to each window, pled the blood of Jesus, and I said, what are you bringing in your house? Who's coming in your house? Spirits dwell in things and places. But what do you bring in? There's things that you can't allow in your life or in your home, because if you bring them in, they're going to hang out. And the more that you feed those spirits, the bigger they're going to get. Right? I was hearing somebody preach today about, they had these toddies, I guess they call them. It's alcohol, a little bit of alcohol with lemon, and they put something to help for your sore throat back in the day. But they were having sore throats every Friday and Saturday night. And they were taking out the lemon and the honey, and they were just going straight up. But see, how many know that whenever you feed that thing, it's going to grow? And you don't need it every weekend. They were putting it in the water so it would cure the water or heal the tummy. A lot of people have been having tummy aches on the weekends thinking they have to have a little bit of this to cure their tummy ache. A lot of people were having tummy aches every weekend. We don't need that. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Dear Jesus, help us. God is not the author of fear. The enemy is. 1 John chapter 4, verse 18 through 19. I'm on a little rare way today. Oh, Jesus. Who's praying for me this week? Because you better start praying more. Amen. 1 John chapter 4, verses 18 through 19. The Bible says, say with me, the Bible says, such love has no fear because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, listen, it is for fear of what? And this shows that we are not fully experienced in his perfect love. We love each other because he loved us first. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, say with me, the Bible says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and discipline. There was a quote that Billy Graham made, and he said, agape love is selfless love. The love God wants us to have isn't just an emotion, but a conscious act of the will, a deliberate decision on our part to put others ahead of ourselves. This is the kind of love that God has for us. Amen? The measure of love is to love without measure. Amen? Think of it this way. The height of our love for God is indicated by the depth of our love for one another. That's good. Amen. Amen. Denise, would you come to the piano for me this morning? In 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 through 10, part of our text this morning, the Bible says, God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and he sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. today when we were singing, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. He chases away the shadows. In this house, they were seeing dark shadows. Things, lights were flipping off and on, happening. I said, do you know there's power in the name of Jesus? He makes the darkness and the shadows fleeting. He chases the darkness out. When you know the authority that you walk in, see, the enemy doesn't want you to know your authority. He doesn't want you to know greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Who's in the world? Satan is. So you have to know your authority, right? You got to know your authority. Greater is he that's in me. You have to be a carrier of his presence. You got to know the word of God. I said, you just plead the blood of Jesus. I told this little girl, you start seeing stuff, you say, in the name of Jesus, I command you to go. I plead the blood of Jesus. I said, that's what you got to do. Prayed over her. She ran up to me and she put her arms around my waist. Just gave me the biggest hug. It's like I gave her a light. Like, thank you. I'm not going to allow anyone to torment me. Not anyone or anything. Smith Wigglesworth was laying in bed one night. He's a mighty man of God. Raised the dead. I think his wife died several times. He'd raise her up. And she said, look. She did. Let me go, Smith. I want to stay in heaven. You can make it without me, Smith. He didn't want her to go. But one night he was laying in bed, the devil showed up in his room. He looked at him and goes, oh, it's just you. Went back to sleep. See, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. You plead the blood of Jesus. There's power in the blood of Jesus. There's power in his name. Amen. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. If we can get that first one down, all the rest will just fall in place. A second is equally important. You gotta love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Amen? And love me. And I'm going to love you. Would you stand with me for a moment? Today we're going to take communion. But I want to make sure that you're okay to take communion. You got to make sure your heart's right before you take communion. Amen? So I want you just to close your eyes for a moment. If there's anything that has disappointed God and disappointed yourself, if you've done something that you know that you need to repent of, just don't say, I'm sorry. Say, Father, I confess. I had to confess this week. You know, sometimes stuff comes in, it's stupid. You feel sorry for yourself. You can't put a dollar amount on your worth. Let me tell you why. You can never put a dollar amount on what Christ did for you. There's not enough money in the world. I couldn't pay somebody to take away my sins. I can't pay someone to make me whole. Jesus paid it all. And all to him I owe. I can't take one thing with me. You cannot put a price tag on what you're worth. Because Jesus paid a big price for you. If you were the only word person here on earth, Katie, Christ would have come just for you. Just for you. Say, she needs me. When God sent his son to die on the cross for our sins, my thoughts, I can't even imagine how great God's love was for me. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God forgets our sins so completely that they might as well be buried at the bottom of the ocean. His love and forgiveness of sins is so lovingly powerful. He removed our transgressions as far as the east is from the west. And I love this scripture. In Isaiah 43:25, the Bible says, Yes, I alone will blot out your sins for my own sake. And I will never think of them again. On purpose, he forgets about what you've done. I wish more Christians would be like Christ. I will forgive you, and I will choose to never think about your sin again, or what you did to me, or what you did to others, or whatever. I choose deliberately to forget, just like Christ. I want to encourage you today to deliberately, actively live out the Holy Scriptures. We will see a love revolution take place in our homes and our world. That's what Christ did. He came to change the world, and he did it all because he loved us. Amen. So if you'd say this prayer with me today, we're going to go right into communion. And I'd like for my ushers to come that are going to help. Like some to stand on this side. Would you stand here, Jim? And I want you to stand here, Tim, facing the people. Heavenly Father, you are so powerful. Your blood washes away every stain, every sin, every thought. I pray today that each one here would consider their days, they would consider their speech, they would consider their thoughts, that they would ask for forgiveness for their sins. Would you pray this prayer with me today? Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for dying on the cross for our sins. Please forgive me. I repent for every bad thought, for every bad word, for every bad deed that I've ever done. Help me to live for you. Give me strength to walk out your holy scriptures. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins, and that you rose again so I would have life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Leviticus chapter 17, the Bible states very simply, for the life of flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes an atonement for the soul. Blood is essential. No other tissue of creation is quite like the blood. With it's a mixture of fluid and tiny bones that are called corpuscles. It flows through the body. Everyone here, every living body is kept alive by blood. And that blood flows through your body, carrying life, nourishment to the body's cells, while at the same time, as it returns back to be filtered, it carries away life, destroying waste. How would like the body of Jesus Christ, the blood of the body? Jesus gives us spiritual life. As he flows through us, he washes us clean, and he takes away from us that which would destroy our spiritual life, just as the blood does in the body. Amen. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make you whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is that flow. Like the body of Christ, the blood of the body, Jesus gives us spiritual life. And as he flows through us, he washes us and cleanses us and takes away from us that which would destroy our spiritual life, just as the blood does in the body. The blood of Christ cleanses totally. Totally. For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose him as your ransom. Long before the world began, but now in these last days, he has been revealed for your sake. Every prophecy in the Old Testament pointed to Christ and his sacrificial blood. Every sacrifice pointed to his bloody cross. Every believer today must look back to the bloody cross of Jesus Christ, the blood of Christ. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that make it an atonement for the soul. The Bible says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. The Bible says, and by the word of their testimony, they are loved. They love not their lives and unto death. Satan is conquered by the blood of Jesus Christ. In the midst of these battles, when you have been losing, you should plead the blood of Jesus Christ. You will find out when you start doing that, the blood conquers Satan. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, the Bible says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. If it wasn't for the blood of Jesus, if it wasn't for his shed blood and his body on Calvary, you could not stand here today and be pure and be clean. Without his precious blood, you would still be carrying your guilt and your shame and all your sin. Amen. But Jesus paid it all. It all to him I owe. Hallelujah. Father, I want to thank you for your precious blood. I want to thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you have done for us. Hallelujah. For I pass on to you what I've received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread, and he gave thanks to God for it. And he broke it into pieces, and he said, Judah, take your bread and break it. And he broke it into pieces. Oh. He said, this is my body. This is my body, which is given for you. I want you to do this in remembrance of me. See, the disciples hadn't seen him crucified yet. They hadn't seen it yet. But this symbol, after the crucifixion, meant so much more. Because they realized what he did. This is his body. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes he was whipped. He was whipped so badly, he said he wasn't even recognized as a man. When the cat of nine tails would whip his back, and the bone and the metal would stick into his flesh, they would rip it out, and chunks of his flesh would come out. For every disease, we shouldn't have to take it. He already did. I already took it for you, baby. Just like we would take it for our children. He took it because he loves us, because we are his children. Roman times, whenever they would whip, they said they were so cruel. And they said, if you could kill the man by whipping him, then all your debts are paid and you will be able to live forever without working another job. Your life will be totally taken care of. So they would whip him so, I don't even know the word. They whipped him to kill him. Just so they could have their life paid. So Jesus was broken, he was whipped, he was bruised for you and I. Let's give him thanks. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you for your sacrifice. Father, I know that when you were bowing and praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, that you were so distressed because drops of blood would fall from your forehead. And you knew what you were going to have to walk through. You were perfect. You knew no sin. It wasn't just the physical beating, but it was just the sin that you had to carry for us, the disease. We want to thank you, Lord. Now, Father, everyone that's here that might be feeling sick or having an issue or a disease, we take this by faith knowing that you already took it. And we ask that you would heal our bodies in Jesus' name. And we thank you for this bread representing your body today in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. His precious blood flows through us, washes us clean, makes us white as snow. Amen. Takes away all the impurities, takes away all the sins, gives us new life. New life, Isla. New life. You take this today, say thank you for the blood. I thank you for the blood of Jesus that washes me, purifies me, makes me whole. Father, we lift up this cup representing your blood, washing away our sins. We want to thank you for the sacrifice. Cleanse us now, Father. Make us whole. We ask these things in your name. We thank you, Lord. Amen.